Amen. Can we praise Jesus for Clay and the band tonight, guys? God using them in our lives. Amen. You ready to get to business? Are you ready to get to business? This is the business of time to study God's Word. I don't know how to work this thing, so I probably wound up tearing it apart, so I'll just leave it like it is. Good deal. Who's ready for it? You ready? Amen. 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 You know, I didn't realize, but I have some West Memphis people up in the house here. I got some Missouri people up in the house here. Anybody else I missed that I didn't know you? From Kansas. I done talked to the Baton Rouge people. Kansas folks. Some Oklahoma people up in the house. Good deal. Amen. I said Texas earlier today. Good deal. The Lord knows who you are. He hadn't forgotten you. I didn't even know you were here, and He already knew. That's what I'm talking about. Good deal. Father in heaven, we love You. We bless Your name for this opportunity. And we want to be careful, Lord, to point to You so that, Father, everything that is done here is to the praise of Your glorious grace and for the power that is Yours, that is not mine. It is Yours, O Lord. So I ask and I pray that You would speak to students. I pray that in every service we have that You would speak to them in ways that their hearts would melt for You. That, Lord, ways of thinking and how to attempt life would melt away, that they could see You calling them to something bigger than themselves. And Father, I pray and I ask that as we take this journey through Your Word, that Lord Jesus, You would encourage us. And Father, where we are lost, that You would save us. So I pray that You would grant public repentance of sin tonight among those who need to know You as their Lord and personal Savior. God, let Your students understand the gospel tonight. And Father, for those who understand the gospel, may their hearts burn for You, that they would savor You above everything else in their hearts and in their life. And we ask these things in the awesome, amazing, wonderful name of Jesus. And all God's students said, amen and amen. Amen. Well, I'm so excited, like I'm trying to contain myself at this point. Yeah, here we go. Sorry. You guys, so you know a little bit about me. I grew up in the 70s and the 80s. I'm a child of the 80s. Any youth pastors and folks here? Yeah. I watch the movies that you are watching as reruns. I watched them when they first came out, okay? And the crazy part about my generation is that here's the thing you need to know about me is I got ADHD, okay? Anybody with me? All right. I grew up in the era we didn't know anything about Ritalin or any kind of medicine. All we knew is a mama just wear you out because you wouldn't sit down. She's like, boy, I ain't going to tell you again. Timeout didn't work at our house. Timeout was the distance in between. My mama hit me, backed up, and hit me again. That's about the only timeout we had. So I say that God, I own my ADHD, okay? I say that God created me to be, or allows me to be overly creative at awfully random times. So I'm so excited right now, like I'm trying to contain all that stuff. You know what I'm saying? So occasionally I may just have to go squirrel, okay, and just cleanse the palate, okay? It's kind of like if you eat sushi, it's like wasabi. The palate cleanser is like pledge to the brain. It gets all the dust out of there. So good deal. Hey, I've got to tell you something. One of the reasons I'm so excited about this camp is because Mullatopia is just absolutely amazing, right? How many of y'all been pretty excited about this? Yeah? Yes. Yeah. One of the reasons I love it is just because, yeah, being a redneck is like hilariously fun. And it's a lot of fun. One of the things I love, and I'm just convinced of, students, is we work into our theme throughout the week. I'm gonna get us there, so hang in here with me. Is one of the things that had to be brought about by people who wear mullets are things called warning labels. You guys ever pay attention to the warning labels on certain products? I do. I love it. Because here's the deal about a warning label. Every product that you buy, somewhere along the box, either on the outside of whatever it is or on the box, has a warning label. Why? Because of this issue. Somebody, somewhere, did something they weren't supposed to do. Right? Is that your brother? Does that describe your brother right there? Does that describe that one dude in y'all's youth ministry? Okay, this is not the camp to do what you shouldn't be doing, okay? All right, you with me? I love, when I go to Walmart, I just pick up stuff to just look to see what the warning label is. Why? Because somebody somewhere did something they shouldn't have done, right? They weren't supposed to do. So I brought a few warning labels tonight. Can I share a few of them with you? And you got to understand that in my mind, like, I want to think about the first time this became an issue. Are y'all with me? So I want to show you one tonight. The first one I have for you is off of the outside box of an iron. All right, y'all know what an iron is? I know this generation probably doesn't. Okay, iron is something that you plug into a wall, you heat up, so you actually walk out of the house without wrinkles in your clothes. Y'all know what wrinkles are? All right, wrinkles. Yeah, wrinkles. All right. Here's what the box says about an iron, John. You ready for this? It says, this activity involves using a hot iron. Only an adult should do this activity. Students, that is not an excuse to pile your clothes up to be all wrinkled, okay? But notice what it's saying. Cardboard, it's for a transfer. Like if you want to make a cool T-shirt with your iron, it says cardboard transfer will still be hot. Do not iron while wearing shirt. Warning labels exist because why? Somebody, somewhere did what? Now, in my mind, I've just got the first call to 911 from this dude, right? Y'all with me? Just hang in here with me. 911, what's your emergency? Yes, can I help you? It hurts! Yes, sir, would you please calm down? It burns! Somebody get some ice! I need help! Security! I don't know what's going on, okay? Finally, the guy calms down. Starts asking, sir, what seems to be the issue? Well, I was getting ready to go out on a date, and I went to do the last check, you know, before I was getting ready to head out. Y'all know what I'm talking about when you get in front of the mirror and you just do the once-over right there, you know? Okay, yeah, y'all know what I'm talking about, all right? And then he saw this wrinkle that was on the backside of his shirt right here and didn't have time to take the shirt back off. So what? Oh, the iron is still plugged in. Guess what? Okay. Who does this? Thank you for those hands. We will be praying for you. The buses will wait. Yes. Who does that? That's insane, right? When I was two, I learned that the iron was hot, right? My mom was like, don't you touch that iron, boy, I'll burn you, right? Who in the world thinks they're going to be saving time by ironing their shirt while it's on or their pants while they're on, right? Okay. Y'all with me? Warning labels exist because what? Somebody somewhere did something they... Can I show you another one? This one cracks me up right here. The stove. Better known as a range. Better known as an oven. On the outside of the box of a stove, it has this. All ranges can tip if you or child stand, sit, or lean on an open door. What mama was the first mama to, after she cooked dinner, said, Law, I'm tired. I got to sit down. Bam! The whole thing just falls over on her. Now, it normally doesn't happen like that, does it? Now, it happens more like this. It's that cabinet right above the stove that's got what you need. Your Kool-Aid, right? That casserole dish, right? And you just, I mean, you're so vertically challenged, you were just that close to getting it. I mean, you just jumped all you can, so you're like, what? Just open the door. And use it to step, bam! Right? Now when one walks in, your mama's got a leg all mashed up in the stove with the door shut on it, right? Warning labels exist because why? Somebody somewhere did what? Something they weren't supposed to. Can I share another one with you? This is my favorite right here. Vending machine. How many of y'all some vending machine junkies? Y'all love you some vending machines. I knew it. Oklahoma people, I see you. Check this one out. It says, never rock or tilt. Machine can fall over and cause serious injury or death. serious. Vending machine will not dispense free product. I don't know which one to go with first right here. Kid just mad, stomping Jason. I see it in there. I want that Snickers. I want it. It won't come out. Right? Now, y'all know how this plays out, right? There you are. You got up late. You about late for school. Barely brushed your teeth. Hair all nappy messed up, unless you're like me and got no hair, okay? Y'all like my hair? I combed it over tonight. I'm going to gel it tomorrow. So check it out. Thank you. So there you are, man. You got $1.25 to your name, and you just want that Pop-Tart, right? You want that Twix. Y'all with me? What's your favorite snack? Little Kit Kat. Little Kit Kat. I hear you, girl. There you. What's your name? Yeah. What's her name? Don't let the big ears fool you. Callie girl. Everybody say, hey, Callie.
Hey.
Callie, me and you right here. Here's Callie. Callie, what time you got to be in school? Bell rings when? 8:05. Homegirl is like 8:03. She got a book bag on her back. She got them flip-flops that don't flip. They just scoot. Y'all know what I'm saying? And she's coming down the hallway. Oh, I done read your mail, didn't I? Yeah. She's doing this number. She's like, I'm so hungry. And you take that one moment where you're like, I can go to class and be on time, but my stomach's going to be growling. I'm going to be ill, right? And the vending machines are right there. Y'all know what I'm talking about, don't you? She throws her book bags to her friend, says, put them in. Put them at my desk. Tell the teacher I'm on my way, right? That's you. That's you. What's your name? What's up, Dynasty? Dynasty got this worked out. Don't you worry about it, girl. You go on. That's what she's saying. Yeah. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Callie is over there dropping her dollar and a quarter in the machine. She is pressed D12 for Kit Kats. And it's on one of them little roundy circle things. Y'all know what I'm talking about, where it's going. And it stops right before. Problem is, Callie won't be denied, will she? Oh, no, she's already late. That thing's about to take her dollar and a quarter. She about to fix this, right? Is that what I'm talking about? So my girl, she gives a little nudge. It don't do nothing. No big old football players around. She is not going to be denied. Homegirl backs up. Pulls her yoga pants all the way up. Kicks them flip-flops off. And just goes in there, Usain Bolt, mad dad. Leaps. I believe I can fly. Bam! Bounces off of it. And the one time in all of history, a 65-pound girl rocks a vending machine, and it goes, bam, and smashes her. Dynasty runs out. Oh, Lord Jesus, what happened to you, girl? You okay, right? Right? I love y'all. I love y'all. I got you. What? What? And you don't act, don't get churchy on me. You know, especially you youth pastors, you know you have rocked some vending machines in your lifetime. I'm a like that, okay? And then it fall over and blame your students. I told y'all, right? Warning labels exist because why? Somebody somewhere did what? Can I share a few more with you? This right here is specifically for Mullitopia. Jet ski fuel tank. In the owner's manual of a jet ski. How many of y'all got a jet ski? I wish I could. I wish I could. Now this, who are our two MCs? What are their names?
Nathan and Cody.
Nathan and Cody. Here's Nathan and Cody out on the river. Just going to town, right? All of a sudden, Cody's jet ski cuts off. Nathan circles around and comes back and says, "Hey, man, what's wrong?" "I don't know, dog. I can't figure it out." "What happened?" "We were just getting it, man. And it cut off. It turned off." "What did it turn off for?" "I don't know. Does it have any fuel in it? Let me check." Cody pulls the cap off the jet ski. "It's dark down in there. I can't see nothing." Nathan says, "That'd be all right. I got a light. Thank you, buddy. Appreciate it." Boom! Who in there, right? Look at it. Unscrew the fuel cap. It says, "Warning, never use a lit match or open flame to check fuel level." Seriously? Seriously. Warning labels exist because why? Somebody, somewhere, did something they weren't supposed to. All right, can I share one more with you? Now, this one right here has changed every family reunion. How many of y'all got one of those families that when y'all have family reunions, y'all so big, you got T-shirts? Okay. This right here has changed every family reunion, every holiday special. It has won more $10,000 on America's Funniest Videos and is the vine that you seek after to watch over and over. I can only imagine how this one happens, but it involves a wonderful thing called a scooter. A two-wheeled handlebar express that has a wonderful warning label right at the handlebars that says, "This product moves when used." Here's how in my mind this plays out. Y'all ready? How many of y'all got that one aunt that loves all the children of the family? Y'all with me? And this aunt, never wants to hang out with the adults. She always wants to hang out with y'all. Y'all know what I'm talking about? She's the one that when you walk in the door or she walks in the door is the first one to give you the biggest bear hug and the sloppiest kiss all over your forehead down the side of your face. Anybody got that aunt? If she's here, don't raise your hand. I don't want any ugly mail, okay? No emails. I can imagine here y'all are chilling. It's Christmas dinner. Your little brother's got his scooter. He got it for Christmas, right? He brought it to hang out. And here comes Aunt Ann out to hang out with y'all. She walks out and says, "What y'all doing out here? Having a good time, just a little talking." You know, she's always so chipper, just talking, right? Y'all know the aunt I'm talking about? She said, "What's going on? Oh, who got this scooter? Let me tell you, back in the day, I could roller skate like nobody's business." And you're like, don't even touch it. She goes, "Oh, this ain't nothing. I got this, yo. I got this, girl. You don't even know about me." And about that time, Aunt grabs a hold of it, puts one foot on it, and goes to push with the other one. And what happens? But Aunt is the one that when she falls, it takes her like an epic journey to fall, right? It's like, and everything. She's grabbing kids. They're yanking them down. Kids got broke necks because of Aunt. Who in the world doesn't know that a scooter moves when used, right? Warning labels exist because what? Somebody, somewhere, did something they weren't supposed to do. Now, here's the craziest thing about this, guys. Is that warning labels, guys, are the truth of the issue that somebody somewhere did something they weren't supposed to do. And here's what's so crazy about this is that for you and for me, the Bible knows that you and I have an inclination to push the envelope on everything. The Bible knows that for you and I, that you and I have a bent, as though our spine is bent and inclined to find the rule and to push the rule and to do what should not be done. And because of this, and because the Bible so clues in on this, students, I want you to understand that the Bible gives us, that God gives us, the greatest warning label of all times. Because somebody somewhere did what? Something they shouldn't have done. And this is the Bible's greatest warning label. If you're taking notes with me tonight, it's simply this. Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death. For the wages of sin is death. What's the scripture talking about? The Bible knows that you and I, while we laugh at the warning labels that are on an iron, that are on a vending machine, that are on a scooter, that are on a jet ski fuel tank, that there are a whole lot of issues within our life to where we have gone and done what should have never been done. And so the Bible lists it out for us. The wages or the result of sin. You see, when we talk about warning labels being somebody somewhere did something they shouldn't have done, we need to localize that. We need to be pinpoint about it. Because guys, here's the truth of the matter. You and I have a spiritual parents called Adam and Eve. God created the heavens and the earth. He created light. He spoke it all into existence. He created animals. He created the firmament. He created water. He spoke it all into existence. And at the pinnacle of creation, He created two beings, Adam and Eve. He created Adam first. He gave Adam the ability to name things like the Holstein cow, the beaver, the duck, the squirrel, the duck-billed platypus. Okay, I guess it was just leftover stuff, and He put it together. And He gave Adam this one commandment. In Genesis chapter 2, as you read the story, He says, Adam, you can eat of any tree of this garden that you want to, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you're not to eat of it, for the day that you eat of it, you will surely die. And then immediately after He gave him that commandment, God says it's not good for man to be alone, and they looked to see if there was a helper suitable for him, and there was not one. And He laid Adam down into a deep sleep, and from his side He drew Eve, to which when Adam woke up, he looked at her and went, whoa, man, right? Woman, right? That's where we get that. He says, this is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. He says, this is just like me, but supersized in all the right places. It's a biblical translation there. Just making sure you're paying attention. We laugh and we snicker about it because we don't see the beauty and the power of those passages. Because our world has traded us something silly and something twisted. But the reason why God gave Adam to Eve was to help her live up to the commandments of God. And that's the reason why God gave Eve to Adam. Their first, number one, primary responsibility in the garden was to help one another say yes to the commandment of God and to resist their own way. But there was a serpent in the garden. And that serpent was their enemy, as he's our enemy today. And he tempted them. You see, because the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they saw it, they looked at it, that it was good for food, it was pleasing to the eyes, and it was able to make one wise. And the serpent tempted Eve and Adam and said, hey, why don't you take from that? And Eve says, we can't eat of that, because the day we eat of it, we'll surely die. And the devil cast to Eve this slander on God, as though God were the most insecure being in the world, because he says, surely, did God really say that? Because here's the real deal, because God knows that the day you eat of it, you'll be just like him, knowing both good and evil. To which they reached out to take what wasn't theirs. And immediately when they took what wasn't theirs, they were walked out of the presence of God and spent the rest of their existence in mad desperation to live in relationship with God. And that's what sin is, students. You see, sin just isn't the wordy dirds that you say or you think. It's more than just a bad attitude toward your parents. It's more than just taking something that's not yours or cheating on a test. Here's what sin is, if you want to define it as you're taking notes. Sin is simply this: choosing your way over God's. Sin isn't like a disease that some people get and others don't. If sinning were a sport, every one of us would be born professional athletes at it. What do we mean by that, Brian? Choosing your way over God's. Think about it this way. How many of you guys, you walk into your house, you drop your books by the door, is that where they belong? No, you take off to your room, and about halfway to your room, you hear from the kitchen, honey! And what's your response? And then you start stomping back, unless you had a mama like Loretta Burgess, like little Loretta 5'4", who'd knock your head off, right? She said, I'm going to tell you right now, I ain't one of your friends. You ain't going to talk to me like that. I'm your mama. Anybody know that kind of crazy mama? Yeah, love that mama. That was my mama, right? Huh? Yep. What's the issue? It's the outward expression of the inward reality. You want to choose your way beyond anybody else's. How many of you guys got your driver's license this year? Speed limit says 55. You drive what? 60, 65, 70. Right? Yeah, what's the issue? Shh, don't lose me in the analogy. What's the issue? Here's the standard, but somehow or another you've chosen your way above the standard, and you even got a list of justifications on why you're justified to drive as fast as you're driving. You've just simply chosen your way over anybody else's. You see, we live in a world that really doesn't believe that sin exists. I was speaking at a college campus earlier this year. In the middle of my sermon, this big old football player stood up in the middle of it and he said, "Hey, what generation are you from, dude? Nobody believes in that silliness anymore." I said, "Are you talking about sin?" He said, "Exactly." I said, "What do you think sin is?" He says, "I think it's just simply learned behavior." I said, "You think sin's learned behavior?" He goes, "Yeah." I said, "Okay. Have you been to a public restroom lately?" To which his response was, "Yes, I'm living in a dormitory. I'm constantly in a public restroom." I said, "I travel a lot, so I'm probably in more different public restrooms than you are." He said, "I'm following you. Where are you going?" I said, "Well, have you ever noticed when you walk into a public restroom?" I said, "Number one, how joyous are you to be in a public restroom?" He said, "Not very, because they're filthy." I said, "Isn't that amazing? That a public restroom is as dirty." And to which I responded and said, "Who lives like that?" He goes, "I sure don't." But I said, "You're exposed to it, aren't you?" He said, "Yep." I said, "When you're in a public restroom, not only are they filthy and you're afraid to touch anything, while you're there, have you ever noticed how there's all kinds of artwork and grammatical expressions?" He said, "Yes." So I said, you're acquainted with the same thing that I've seen in public restrooms, that there's artwork that should have never been drawn, and there are things that have been said with certain digits that it should have never been scratched out on private property or public property." He said, "Yes." I said, "Well, now let's think about it this way. You just said that sin is learned behavior." He said, "Yes." I said, "Well, you went to preschool, I'm assuming." He said, "Yeah." I said, "You made it through kindergarten." He said, "Yes." I said, "You have been to elementary school." He said, "Yes, sir." I said, "You went to middle school." He said, "Yes, sir." "You made it through high school, obviously." He said, "Yes." "Graduated on the top of my class." And I said, "Now here you are working on your undergrad. You're an educated man, right?" He said, "Yes, sir, I am." I said, "Well, I too didn't go to preschool, but I made it through kindergarten, elementary school, middle school, high school, undergrad, master's, and a doctorate." And I said, "Dude, I don't know about you, but I've never once had the opportunity to sign up for how to mess up a bathroom class. Have you?" He said, "Come to think of it, I haven't." I said, "Why?" He said, "Because the class doesn't exist." So I looked at him and I said, "So what you're telling me is that you never were taught to treat a bathroom like that?" He said, "No, I haven't." I said, "But it still happens, correct?" He said, "Yes, it does." I said, "You want me to express what it is?" He said, "Yeah, go ahead." I said, "It's this. People go in private, do what they want to do because it's not their responsibility to clean it up and write all kinds of filthy things. You know what it is? It's someone choosing their own way over anyone else's. And the Bible calls it sin." I said, "You want to keep going?" Homeboy, sit down. I mean, he couldn't eat me. He looked like he could, but he couldn't eat me. Right? You with me? And here's the case in point, students, whether you believe sin exists or not. It's so funny, we kind of laughed about our speeding, but here's the biggest thing that we know: sin actually exists, because there's a warning label. The result of choosing your way over God's is what? Death. One of the most prolific, profitable businesses on the face of the earth is the funeral home business. Why? Because the warning label is true. Somebody, somewhere, did something they weren't supposed to do. That somebody was Adam and Eve, that somewhere was the garden, and what they weren't supposed to do was choose their own way over God's. Now, you and I have been radically affected by it, so that the point that of even at birth, born in sin, the Scripture says, that we are born with a bent to choose our way over God's, and it makes us an enemy to God. It puts us in rather difficult scenarios. And it's not just localized to this area or to that area or to inner city or places where there's no sophistication. Notice what the Scriptures teach us in Romans chapter 3 about how pervasive sin is. It says, "For all have what?" And how do we define sin? Sin is what? Choosing your way over Come on, let's get this right, because I don't want you to leave this place just thinking, oh, that's sin. See, because what I'm finding over the years as I work with students is I find people will always list out things that they could never see themselves doing as sin. Y'all with me? But the truth of the matter is, it's down inside of us, and it makes us an enemy to God. Sin is simply choosing your way over whose? Come on, talk to me. Sin is simply what? Choosing your way over God's. And here's the biggest issue. He says, Paul says in Romans, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Why do we fall short of the glory of God? It's because I have a bent in my spine towards sin. I have a radical inclination in my head towards sin. I have a passion for one thing. I want to live for my glory rather than God's glory. Therefore, the warning label exists. The result and the payment of sin is death. You know why warning labels exist? Because somebody somewhere did what? Something they shouldn't have done. And the large reason now why warning labels have to be posted on material, on products, is this. When somebody somewhere does something they're not supposed to do, guess what? Somebody has to pay for it. Somebody has to pay for it. Someone has to pay for my mistakes. And just as it's true in merchandise, I want you to understand that it's true with our soul. Here's God's payment plan. Isaiah 53:6. This is what the prophet Isaiah saw thousands of years before Christ ever came. He says, we all like sheep have gone astray. Each one, what? Choosing our own, come on, way. But the Lord, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Iniquity is just another word for sin. It talks about the disease of sin. Sin is simply missing the mark. But it's more than just missing the mark. It's with no ability to hit the mark, not on our own. Because why? I want to live for my own glory. I want to do my own thing. And if you press me hard enough, I'll show you how much I want to do my own thing. You see, students, what I'm finding is simply this. My biggest issue in living for Jesus isn't that I don't have a cool church to go to. My biggest issue in living for Jesus isn't that I don't have a cool youth pastor, a cool Bible to read, or a cool camp like this one to come to. My biggest issue in living for Jesus is this. I love myself way more than I love God. But here's what's so beautiful about that scenario, is that God's love for me and His love for His glory is much bigger than His hatred toward my sin. And His payment plan was this. 2,000 years ago, He drove a stick in the ground and hung His one and only Son on it to cancel out the warning label. To cancel its effect in your life and in my life. You see, it wasn't just the cross, students, but what you have to understand is the full work of Jesus Christ. You say, Brian, how? We're supposed to be talking about Jonah. Where? How does this work? Because you're going to understand here in just a little bit as we work through this that Jonah was a prophet who came to list out the warning labels. And the largest warning label that any prophet lists out is the issue of sin. And for you and I, we have to get this issue in our life before we can begin to think about how to go global. Because sin is tricky. Fighting sin is a guerrilla warfare, and so you have to have someone who can full well handle it. And this is where the power of the gospel is. You see, the gospel is more than just a tract that you leave and a cheap tip after a meal at a restaurant. The gospel is more than just the ABC prayers that maybe some of you prayed in Vacation Bible School when you were 8 years old. The gospel is the most beautiful, romantic, testosterone-filled message I have ever heard in my life. Why? Because it handles the issue that somebody somewhere did something they weren't supposed to do. And God handled it by sending the one to a specific place to do what no one else could do. Jesus Christ came. God, who is spirit, took flesh from a woman, and for some 33 years, we believe, lived in that flesh sinlessly. He never chose His way over the Father's. Never, ever, ever. The Bible tells us in Hebrews 4:15 that He was tempted in every way we are, yet remained without sin. How do we define sin, students? Simply choosing what? Your way over God's. He never chose His way. So in other words, He was tempted in ways that we wouldn't mind anybody knowing we've been tempted, like speeding. And he's been tempted in ways in which we wouldn't want anybody knowing we've been tempted. But he never chose his way over the Father's. He was blameless. He was perfect. He won for you and I the righteous requirement of God to be set apart. But it didn't stop there. God drove a stick in the ground and he took his one and only son, blameless son, and he hung him on that cross. In essence, to say, as Jesus stretched out his hands and his feet, he said, "Father, don't punish them, but punish me in their place, and to display your great love for them throughout all of eternity." So whether you see a cross on the roadside commemorating someone's accidental death, whether it's on a necklace around the cashier at Walmart, or whether you see it on the top of a building like this known as a church, you need to understand one thing about the message of the cross when you see it. It's more than architecture, it's more than jewelry, and it's more than just a fond remembrance. It is the one message that says there is deliverance from warning labels. There is a deliverance from the power of sin, and it's found in the sacrificial death of Jesus Christ. That when there was nothing lovely about you and you were an enemy to God, God took you just as you were, but won't leave you the same way He found you. When there was nothing attractive about you, when there was nothing willing to come to God, God loved you just as you are. He had compassion on you, and the demonstration of His compassion is His sacrificial, is His blameless Son on a cross. Woo! Isn't that amazing? See, here's the deal, the world I live in, if people knew my life, many of them would leave. But you have a Father in heaven who knows exactly what you're like, what's hidden inside of you, and how awful you are toward Him. And He said, "I'm not just going to not leave, I'm going to leave my throne and I'm going to come get near you so I can do in you what no one else can do, I can rescue you." He lived sinlessly, He died sacrificially, oh, but He rose victoriously. Why? Because He's going to cancel the power of that warning label on your life. Cancel it. And we call it the great exchange. On the cross, Jesus takes all my sin, I get all His righteousness. He takes all my punishment, I get all of His peace. He takes my death, I get His life. You see, here's the teaching point. He came so you could change. He came so you could change. Jonah is sent to Nineveh to preach to the Assyrians in Nineveh because their sin is so great it has come up before God. I'm going to say more about this all tomorrow night. I'm going to walk you Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday through the book of Jonah. We're going to have fun in it. Before we can get to Jonah's message, we got to understand God's message for you. Because God's message for you is linked to what we'll study the rest of the week. Many of you are raised in a performance-driven culture that you got to perform. You got to do. And with God, students, you need to understand, none of us can, none of us are, none of us will ever be able to be what we need to be for His glory apart from Jesus Christ. And He loved you so much that He gave His blameless Son to come take your place and my place on a cross, to become the target for all of God's just wrath because of our sin, choosing our way over His. And He absorbed every bit of it so He could release His great love, His great mercy, His great forgiveness to you. And students, this is the gospel. And you know what you got to do to receive this? You know what you got to do to receive God's compassion, His salvation in your life? You got to be smart enough? Got to work enough? Got to go to church enough? Got to be a certain part of a denomination? No. There's nothing you can do except this. Turn from choosing your way and turn to accept His grace. Romans 4:5, a verse I think that needs to be memorized as much as John 3:16, is this. To the student who does not work but trusts God, to that student is credited righteousness. You cannot work for what only God can give. You cannot perform for what only God got right. And you cannot gain what only God has the ability to give to you. Students, some of you have been ignoring the warning label. The wages of choosing your way over God's is death. But Christ came to destroy sin, death, hell, and the grave. He did it on a cross 2,000 years ago. And He did it so that He could take you just as you are, but not leave you the same way He found you.
It's time for him to become your Savior. It's time to become him to become your Lord. Because either way, there's going to be a payment for your mistakes and for mine. And you got one of two choices. You can either let that payment be an eternity away from him, a continued guilt, I'm going to try harder, I'm going to do better, I'm going to make it right. That'll take you all the way to an eternity apart from him. Or you can let him make the payment for your mistake. And out of his great love, change everything about you. This is the gospel. This is Jonah's message. It's time to pay attention to the warning label. Because he came to do what no one else could do. Because you need what no one else has but he. He came so you could change. Would you pray with me? Father in heaven, I love you and I bless your name for your goodness. I thank you, Lord, for the power of your word and the truth of it. Thank you, Lord, that though the wages of sin is death, the truth of the matter is the verse continues. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. And Father, there are students here who need you. Not to be their religious feel-good, not to just get through a rough season in their life. There are students here who are ignoring the warning labels. And you have spoken to them by the power of your Holy Spirit. You have quickened their hearts and their minds that they could understand the power of your gospel. That it's more than just a Sunday story, but that it infiltrates, you infiltrate every part of our life because you are the gospel. You are the good news that while the wages of my sin brings only death, your gift brings life. And so Jesus, I pray that you let life enter into the hearts and the lives of students here. With every head bowed and every eye closed, I wonder if there's a student here who says, Brian, that's me. I've ignored the warning labels. Throughout my middle school and teenage years, my existence thus far, it has all been about choosing my way over anybody else's. I push the limits and I push the limits and now I see the danger of it. Because I realize it's not just an issue of ignoring my parents. It's not just an issue of being troubled at school. It's not just an issue of annoying my youth pastor. Pushing the limits is a real issue between me and God. And I want that issue to be taken care of tonight. I want him to forgive me of my sins and save me. You see, the gospel is this: you and I are sinners. God developed an amazing plan since the creation of the world. He would give his one and only blameless, sinless son to die sacrificially in your place and mine on a cross, to be raised victoriously, and to make a promise that he's coming back one day. But he was coming back to rescue those who would put their faith in him. Would you put your faith in him tonight? Would you let him pay the penalty for your mistakes? Would you let him save you? If that's you tonight, I want to help you. Help me do what, Brian? Call upon the name of the Lord. Why do I need to call upon the name of the Lord? Because the scriptures say this: whoever calls upon the name of Jesus will be saved. So if you know you need to be saved tonight, the warning label is blaring in your face. You're at odds with God. And without what Jesus Christ did on the cross, you would spend an eternity away from him. I want to help you call upon the name of the Lord. Now, I want to be very clear about this. What we're getting ready to do is for salvation. This is not for rededication. You cannot rededicate what has never been Jesus's. So I want to be very clear. This is a moment for salvation. And the prayer that we're going to pray doesn't save you, but the authority of Scripture, where it says, Romans chapter 10, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. I just want to help you call on Him and let Him do what He does best. Forgive sins, accept you graciously, seal you with the power of His Holy Spirit, and now give you new life. You know you need to be saved tonight. Here's what I want to ask you to do. Just simply borrow my words. Don't pray them to me. I cannot save you. Pray them to Jesus. Would you pray with me and say, Jesus, I realize my great need for you. I have chosen my way over yours, and that makes me a sinner. And my sins have set a barrier between you and I am in danger of making an eternal payment for my sins apart from you. But I trust that what you did on the cross through your sinless life, sacrificial death, and powerful resurrection, that you are everything I need to be right with God. I turn from my sins, and in faith I turn to you. Forgive me of my sins. Be my Savior. Be my Lord. Rescue me. I will follow you. Now with every head bowed and every eye closed, no one looking around, if you borrowed my words tonight, were as sincere as you possibly could be and gave your life to Christ and asked Him to forgive you of your sins and to save you, here's what I want to ask you to do. When I count to three, I want you to raise your hand. Here we go. Ready? Lord, I trust you for this right now. You are the Lord of the harvest, and the harvest still exists. So I trust you right now to grant students public repentance of sins. When I count to three, raise your hand. Here we go. Ready? One, two, three. Raise them and raise them high. Raise them high. Don't put them back down. Raise them high. All over this room, keep them raised. Anybody else? Now, those of you who have your hands raised, here's what I'm going to ask you to do. Keep them up. When I count to two, I want you to stand to your feet. Why do I have to stand to my feet, Brian? Because Christ calls you publicly. And we're going to celebrate you publicly. This is His moment in your life right now. You just gave your life to Christ. I did not give a prayer for rededication. It was a moment for salvation. You prayed with me and were sincere as you possibly could be about asking Jesus to forgive you of your sins and save you. When I count to two, I want you to stand to your feet. Here we go. Ready? One, two, stand. Come on, stand. Woo! Amen. Anybody else? Saw a lot of hands over here. Maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you prayed with me, and right now you're real nervous. You're like, oh, just grab the person next to you and say, hey, stand with me. I'm scared to death, but Jesus just saved me. Stand up with me right now. I need to make this public. Go ahead. Praise God. Anybody else? Those of you who are standing, I want you to make your way right here. Come on right now. I'm way over my time limit, but this is well worth it. Come on, come on. Amen. Amen. That's why we came. Woo-hoo-hoo! Woo! What's your name?
Anisha.
Your shirt says strive to greatness. Girlfriend, that's what you just did. You just reached out to greatness, the greatness of our great Lord. Amen. Anybody else, give your life to Christ, but you didn't stand up. I'm glad the Lord can see you because I about couldn't. Camouflage. Amen. Anybody else, give your life to Christ, and you need to be down here with us right now. There's freedom in this place. Don't miss this. Don't worry about your boyfriend, your girlfriend. Don't worry about what your youth pastor is going to think. Don't worry about the person sitting next to you, what they're going to think. You just give your heart and life to Christ. I'm beckoning you. I'm in the power of the Holy Spirit saying, please, come on right now. Come on right now. I'm going to give you 10 seconds. Here we go. One. Two. Don't be looking around wondering. Pray, students. Pray for them if you're a Christian. Three. Four. Five. Six. Come on. Seven. Eight. Nine. Anybody? Ten. It's us. We're going to let them listen for a second. The reason you're standing here right now is you understand your great need for Jesus. You understand the reason why you're here is you can't work for your salvation, but He freely died for you on a cross, took your penalty, your place on the cross, took your sins upon Him, became the target of all of God's wrath, and lovingly died in your place and rose victoriously to cancel the power of sin, death, hell, and the grave against you. Does that make sense? Is that why you're standing? Is that why you're here? I want you to understand what just happened is you went from death to life like that by the power of God. Yes. Yes. His banner over you is love. His banner over you is love. Everything you've ever done against Him or will ever do has been separated as far as from the east is to the west. He's drowned it in the deepest of oceans, posted a no fishing sign. You are what the Bible calls born again. And like my little girl, Georgia Rain, I can't leave you by yourself. Because now we've got to follow Him in baptism. Outward expression of the inward reality. Now we're going to start learning how to study His Word so we can follow Him. Now we're going to learn what the church is in our life. That you just don't go to church, you are the church. And so now you're to serve His church that meets regularly and locally and does things for His glory. And the biggest reason is so that you can go to the nations now and tell them of the great love that has invaded your heart and took you from death to life. Amen? So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to pray for you. And then I'm going to send guys, I'm going to send you this way. And young ladies, I'm going to send you this way. And you're going to meet with some of my friends. So college leaders, youth adults, I want you to get ready. And what they're going to do is they're going to just get your name and contact information, find out where you go to church, and so that we can follow up with you. So muy importante that we spend some time with you so that you know how sealed you are in Christ. And here's the thing I want you to understand. You don't need to get saved again. If you're as authentic as you can be, Jesus says in John 10:28, those the Father has given me, I will lose none of them. He never loses you. You with me? So here's what I want you to do. I just want you to turn your hands up just like that as though you're giving up. As you're giving up a gift. I want you to take 10 seconds, and I just want you to, in your own words, just thank Jesus for saving you right now. You ready? And then I'm going to pray for you. And then we're going to send girls this way. You're going to meet with the ladies over here. Young men, you're going to go this way, and you're going to meet with men there. Before I pray, is there any young man or any young woman that says, I just gave my life to Christ, but I was afraid to stand and walk down front, but I know I just got saved. Can I encourage you to come on right now? Come on right now. I wouldn't ask if I didn't have the urgency in my heart. Some of you just need 5 seconds of insane courage to feel the fear and do it anyway. And come on right now. Come on. Praise God. Come on. Come on. Anybody else? Yes. What's up? What's up with that? That's what I'm talking about. Anybody else? All right. 10 seconds. You just talk to the Lord and say, thank you for saving me, in your own words. Father, I thank you and I praise you that you just rescued 32 students from the power of sin, death, hell, and the grave. I thank you, Lord Jesus, that while I'm talking to a lot of church kids, you have let many come to an understanding of your great salvation in their life. And Father, I pray now that as they're giving themselves up to you and you are sealing them with the power of the Holy Spirit for salvation, that dear Heavenly Father, you would give them a great understanding in their mind and in their heart, that their passion, their one and holy passion would be you and you glorified in their life. Bless them with these counselors as they spend time working with them. that they would have a great sense of understanding that there is nothing they can do to earn their salvation, but you have earned it for them, that they could be set free in freedom to belong to you forever. And it's in Jesus' name that I pray. And all God's students said, amen. Young ladies, if you'll go this way. Young men, if you'll go this way right here. Yes. 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 Woohoo! There's the deal. Amen. One last question. You guys enjoy tonight? Amen. Learn something? Okay. Hang in here with me. We're going to get to Jonah. But you got to understand Jonah's message, and it was a message of repentance. But you also got to understand what God looks at. God looks on the heart and has compassion because it's going to be an issue for Jonah. But here's my last question for you before Clay and them lead us in a song. Some of you in this room are still sitting here because you don't know Jesus and you could care less. And to you, I warn you, do not put off such a great salvation. The worst thing God could ever do to you is say, okay, that's how you want to live? Have at it. That's what happened to Nineveh ultimately. Nahum prophesies after Nineveh repents and then goes back to their old ways. And they are finally destroyed. Don't be destroyed when you have such a life-saving message right here at your grasp. So if that's you and you need to, if you're a young lady and you say, I need to talk to somebody about my salvation, just go right now. If you're a young man and he says, man, I know I need to be saved, go right now. Go right now. But there are some of you here, a majority of you, I really do believe I'm talking to a large church crowd. You know Jesus as your personal Savior. At least you think you do. Many of you just have the answers here, but you have other passions here. And to you, I want you to know, don't ignore the warning label. The wages of choosing your way over God's is death. Students, there's no way that you can say you know Jesus and love Him if you are never read God's Word, if you are sarcastic toward His church, if you are reluctant to be associated and to participate in the things of Jesus, and if you are totally embarrassed to share your faith. 1 John says it like this, to the student who says, I know Him, but does not obey Him, is a liar, and the truth of God is not in him. Why? Because you can't have the Spirit of Jesus Christ living inside of you and live as though Jesus doesn't exist. Doesn't work that way. That's Bible. That's not Brian. And so for those of you tonight who say, I do know Him, Brian, but I'm just lost in the game. I'm just enjoying being young, wild, and free. And now I realize there's a consequence. If that's you tonight and you know Jesus as your personal Savior, but you've been ignoring the warning label, then here's what I'm going to encourage you to do. All around this building is a place for you to kneel down and simply sit before God and say, I know you, but I've been living as though you don't exist. And I need to repent and to turn from choosing your way and to turn to Him tonight. So Clay's going to lead us. Jesus paid it all. This is going to be your moment. You don't have to wait till I end this prayer. You can come on right now if you know you need to repent of your sins. You see, unbelievers repent for salvation, but believers repent for fellowship. And some of us need to do that tonight before we go any further in this camp. So let me pray for you. Again, you don't have to wait. You can come on now. But humble yourself before God and say, I want to make it right. Jesus, you paid it all. All to you we owe. Thank you for by your blood, you have washed away the stain of sin. Now, Lord, hear the prayers of your students that genuine repentance would happen as they humble themselves before you. Father, free them from guilt and shame. Free them from the persuasiveness to choose their way over yours. And dear Heavenly Father, set them free that tonight they would choose you so that we can tell the world about you. Hear their prayers now. In Jesus' name. You come, students.